Hey everyone, Christian here, and in this video we protect your entire home network with a firewall. I show you how to deploy the free home version of Sophos XG and manage all your network devices, set up security policies and scan the network traffic against malware and harmful websites. But first, if you might ask why you should even put a firewall solution in your home network and whether this makes sense or not, let's talk about it. A firewall is a great way to protect any network because you can set up the firewall as a central point to manage all your network traffic in your network and better control what's allowed to come in and go out there. And you can protect all devices in your network with a firewall. It doesn't really matter if this is a smartphone, a tablet, a desktop PC, or a server. You can even set up the firewall to look inside the network traffic and filter it based on the website or application to block any explicit web content, games, ads, or things like that. That's also, by the way, a very common way how companies are protecting their networks. Also, in large network environments, firewalls are usually controlling the entire company's network traffic to protect the infrastructure. And if you now think, well, Christian, that all sounds very nice, but how do I do this stuff in a small home network where I'm just running a few devices or maybe just one or two home lab servers? So that's exactly what we're doing in this video. And don't worry, it's not as complicated as it sounds. Today, there are many different vendors of firewall products existing that you could use in a home lab. So some products are open source, some other ones have proprietary solutions, some are made for small home networks with just a basic feature set, but other ones are really targeted to more professional IT environments. And I'm personally running the Sophos XG at home, which is a proprietary firewall solution made by Sophos, and I'm going to show you that in this video. So I want to point out that there is nothing terrible about other products that made me choose this system. I'm very well aware of open source alternatives like OpenSense or pfSense, for example. However, Sophos is a company where I'm working now over 5 years, and the Sophos XG firewall is one of these products I've been working with, so I'm already very familiar with it. It's a next generation firewall that will give you powerful protection and performance in any network. It has a deep packet inspection that allows you to decrypt and inspect any traffic without using a transparent or static proxy. You can buy hardware appliances in different sizes, from small home offices to more giant data center versions, or deploy it in Microsoft Azure or Amazon's AWS cloud. But Sophos also offers the same operating system of their firewalls as a free home edition. You can just deploy in a virtual machine or install it on a small PC. So you'll get an enterprise-grade firewall product that's used in professional environments entirely for free. The only limitation you have is that the free home edition available for non-commercial use can only utilize up to 4 CPU cores and 6 GB of memory, which still should be feasible for any home network. It's also only running on an x86 architecture with at least 2 network cards, so you can't run this on a Raspberry Pi, for example. But if you have a hypervisor like Proxmox or you use it on a physical PC with 2 network cards, that works perfectly. I'm running a home server with Proxmox anyway, so it's straightforward for me because I just added an Ethernet card into that server and could simply run the firewall on it. And with the AMD Ryzen CPU and 6 GB of memory dedicated to that virtual machine, I'm getting enough speed in my home network even when enabling traffic filtering or packet inspection. Okay, so that sounds all very nice, but how do you even put a firewall in your home network? Because if you never have used a firewall before, you might just ask, how do I connect this to my router, or how do I connect my local devices to it? And I will show you the easiest way to do it, which will also cover most of the use cases people have. So for example, in my home network, I have a router where I connected all my devices to be able to access the internet. So all my computers, laptops, smartphones, and all other devices were directly connected to that same router. Some were connected with cables, some were connected over Wi-Fi. So all the devices got an IP address from the router and used it as their primary DNS server to be able to connect to the internet. And this is probably how most of your setups will also look like. So now, if you want to route all this traffic through a firewall, you need to change this topology a little bit. We need to split the network into 2 parts, a wide area network and a local area network. And now we connect all our devices, our laptops, PCs and servers to the firewall's LAN port and the router to the firewall's WAN port. So in this case, the Sophos XG, the firewall, will now handle the DHCP and DNS server for all our local network devices, and it creates a new network with a different IP address range. And because the Sophos XG is now the primary DNS server and the default gateway for all our devices, they will need to send their traffic through it when they want to connect to the internet. If you have any Wi-Fi devices, you probably should also consider that you will need an additional access point to connect all the devices to the local area network. Because if you just link your devices to your existing router's Wi-Fi, these devices wouldn't be connected to the XG and simply bypass the filtering. And you also probably need a network switch to be able to connect all wired devices to the Firewall's LAN port. So you can see, even in a small home network, there are some things you need to consider, but trust me, this is just a perfect example of how to set up a company's network, and it will help you when you want to learn more about network technologies or how computer networks operate. I can just encourage you to learn about essential network technologies like DHCP, DNS, subnetting, and all this stuff that we need in IT. And if you need help or you have any questions, well, that's a good time to join our Discord and talk to other IT guys. As I said in the beginning, how you know set up the Sophos XG is completely up to you. You can just download the software and install this on a physical PC where you add two network cards, or as I'm doing it right now in my setup, I use a server with Proxmox to deploy it. It's not really different from using a physical PC. The network topology is exactly the same. And that's exactly what I'm going to show you in this tutorial. We will install the Sophos XG on our Proxmox server, so let's just start doing this. Okay, so to start installing the Sophos XG on any physical PC or on our Proxmox server, we first of all need to download the firmware installer from the official Sophos homepage. So just go to the official homepage sophos.com and go to Business Products and All Products. And then simply scroll down to the section Free Tools. So this is where you can download a bunch of different tools that Sophos gives away for personal home usage completely for free. So you can find their antivirus solution Sophos Home for PCs and Macs, and also the Sophos Firewall Home Edition. So this is where you click on download. And now you can read a little bit about the Sophos XG features you can use in your home lab or some of the requirements. They also mention the compatibility that the software appliance can be installed on a dedicated Intel compatible PC, but you can also run this with an AMD Ryzen CPU or run it in a virtual machine. I will show you how to do that. So click on Get Started. Now you need to fill in your name and your email address, because Sophos will send you a serial number by email. And this will take you to the download page and will give you some instructions and also a getting started guide, which you can look up if you want to learn more about the system. But we're not using this download here, because the download is only for the Sophos Firewall OS software image. So when you would install this on a physical PC, you can simply just proceed with this download. But if you want to run this on a virtual machine, you should do something instead. So let's go to this menu here and click on Licenses and Account. And now you need to sign in with your Sophos ID. So if you don't have a Sophos account yet, you simply can create a new Sophos ID. It's completely free, so click on that and simply go through the process. And if you're logged in, you need to navigate to the My Sophos portal, which will take you to the licensing portal that is formerly called My Sophos. And now you can manage and see all your registered devices, serial numbers. So go to Network Protection. And then you can register a new device. So when you click on that registration, you need to fill in your serial number and add some information, but you just really need to set up the company's name and the country. And once you registered your device successfully, simply click on Download Installers. So this will take you to the page where you can download the installers for all the different operating systems. So for example, you also find the hardware installers there, which won't work with the Sophos home serial number, by the way, but also the virtual installers for VMware, for Microsoft Hyper-V, for KVM. So this is what we need for Proxmox, by the way, for Citrix, and also the software ISO when you want to install that on a physical PC. So I will select the KVM image and download it. And this will download a zip file you simply just need to extract. And in the folder, you will find two files here, two copy on write disk images for the primary disk and the auxiliary disk. And we now need to create a new virtual machine in Proxmox and attach those two disks to the virtual machine. So let me show you how to do that. So let's start with the creation process of the virtual machine. And you can see that I'm already running a few virtual machines here and also a Sophos XG home appliance. So this is my real home production setup that I don't want to change, because otherwise that will break my existing network. So let me demonstrate how you would go through that process by creating a new virtual machine and simply name this Sophos Test, for example. So now on the next page, we simply select Do Not Use Any Media, because we don't need to install anything. And in the system section, just go with the default. On the hard disk as well, because we later need to remove that hard disk and replace it with our disk images that we've just downloaded. And in the CPU section, you can utilize up to 4 CPU cores for the XG home version. If you need more resources, like more CPU cores or more memory, you would need to buy a real license from one of the Sophos channel partners, and it is based on a subscription model. But for the free home version, you can just use 4 CPU cores and 6 GB of memory. So I will just enter this and let's go to the next section. So now in the network device configuration, we just simply click on next because we will configure the network settings later and just confirm it. So now when you created the new virtual machine, let's click on that and go to the hardware section. And the first thing we want to do is we need to detach the hard disk because we don't need it anymore, and then click on the unused disk to remove it completely. So now we want to import our new virtual hard disks that we have just copied on our PC, and I will just use SCP to copy those files onto the Proxmox server. So just go to the folder where you have downloaded and extracted those two images and just use a tool like SCP to copy this to your Proxmox server. So just use SCP those two files and use your username and the IP address or DNS name of your server and put it in the folder varlib vz template QMO. So once you've uploaded the files, open an SSH session onto the Proxmox server, go into that folder and then use a command that is called qm import disk. And then we will need to use the identifier of our virtual machine. If you don't know that number, it is this number in front of the name and you will find in the Proxmox web interface. And then I want to use the primary disk first, and I want to import this to my local LVM storage. So this is a place where you store all the virtual hard disks for your virtual machines. So hit enter, and this shouldn't really take long, and simply do the same process for the auxiliary disk as well. And if you now refresh the hardware section of your virtual machine, you should see two unused disks here. And the first one should be the primary disk. So click on edit and attach this to the virtual SCSI controller. We do the same for the second hard disk as well. And now we are almost there. We just need to add another network card interface. So to just demonstrate how that works in my network and what you would need to set up on your Proxmox server, just go to the Proxmox and select the network section in the systems menu. And then you find all the network cards and all the network settings of your Proxmox server. And you can see that I've attached two network cards to this physical server, but I've created more bridges here. So let me just quickly walk you through that, because the first network card is attached to the VM bridge 0, which is my local network. So on this network port, I've attached a switch that connects all my wired devices, such as my home server, my laptops, my server, and also my access point that will connect all the Wi-Fi devices. And on the VM bridge 1, I've connected the router's LAN port. So this is where my uplink is, and I've named this wide area network, and the first one would be the local area network. So because I'm running this in my home network, I don't want to break it, because the Sophos XG will also launch a DHCP server once you installed it. This would completely confuse the network and obviously break it. So I'm creating a virtual bridge that I've attached to no physical network, but it is named the LAN staging, where I've attached a virtual Windows PC that we use to simulate a local area network. And I also added another bridge that is called DMZ. You could also attach to the Sophos XG and manage different interfaces. So for example, when you have some virtual machines you want to put on a separate interface and isolate them from the local area network, you could also do that by creating a new virtual bridge, attach this virtual bridge to the Sophos XG and all your virtual machines, and then use it as a separate interface. We probably are going to do that in a future video, because this will be probably too confusing for this one. So what you need for your setup is you just need one local area network and one wide area network. So let's go back to the Sophos test virtual machine and let's add another network interface, because we need that. And then we have two network cards. So now we need to attach those network cards to the correct bridge. And this is how it works on Sophos XG by default. The first network card usually will be dedicated to the local area network zone inside the Sophos XG. And the second network card will be usually dedicated as a wide area network. So you should select the first network card, click on edit, and put this into the local area network bridge. And the second network card should be attached to my router's network. So this will be the VM bridge 1, the wide area network. So let's click on OK. And now we are almost there, but we first of all need to go to the options, change the boot order, because otherwise this wouldn't boot. So just disable everything and just enable the primary disk, which should be connected to the SCSI0 controller. Let's click on OK, and now we are ready to boot up the firewall. So just simply click on start. And now into the console, you can see the firewall's operating system is booting with the current firmware. If you upgrade your firewall's firmware, it will show up two separate firmwares, because the Sophos XG also stores the previous firmware on a secondary partition, and it also holds a separate configuration setting. So if you migrate this to a newer version and something goes wrong, you can always revert back to your old firmware and your old configuration, which is pretty nice. And let's first log into the console. The default password is admin, and this will take us to a menu. We simply need to accept the end user's license agreement, and then you could also activate the device or configure some of the network setting. So when you want to activate your device with your serial number, it should have an internet connection, otherwise this wouldn't work. But we're doing this later in the web UI because I don't like to do it in the console. But just to show you what you can do here, you can go to network configuration, go to interface configuration, and then you can see that the port A is dedicated as a local area network port, and it has this IP address. So it has the 172.16.16.16, which is the IP address of our firewall. And on the secondary port, you can check if it got an IP address from your router's DHCP server. So this will be your uplink, and it should be your local network from your router. And you can see in my case, it got an IP address from my Fritzbox, so that's totally fine. And in this console menu, you can do some configuration settings, but definitely not all. You can do some fine-tuning stuff, and you could also go to the device console and make some settings or run some diagnostic stuff here. But the main firewall configuration will be done in a web interface. So just go to a PC that is connected to the local area network of your firewall and just open a web browser and try to access the firewall on the IP address, and the port is 4444. And then it will take us to the installation or the configuration wizard when you boot the firewall the first time. So we need to accept the end user's license agreement, and first of all need to set up a secure admin password. And then it will walk us through some basic configuration settings. So first of all, select the firewall's name and time zone, and just fill in your serial number that you've just registered in your MySophos account. And now in this menu, you can see which licenses are currently active, and we could now just continue with the installation wizard, set up some firewall rules, and set up the basic configuration of our firewall. But I don't want to do it through the wizard because I want to show you how to set up this firewall step by step. And let's go over this, so let's just click on skip to finish. And when the firewall has rebooted, you should see a login screen where you simply just need to log in with the admin user and your created password. And when you boot up the firewall the first time, it will prompt you to create the secure storage master key. So the master key is important to protect the firewall's internal configuration set. You are not able to restore any backup or the firewall system without that key anymore. So when you set up this key, make sure you are storing that in a secure location, in a password manager or somewhere where you always can retrieve it. And in the new version, you can also manage the Sophos XG through a Sophos Central account, which is the cloud management solution of Sophos, where you can manage all the different products. You can use that for your Sophos XG completely for free, so just check it out, it's pretty nice. But for this tutorial, I simply want to show you the basic firewall configuration and how to use this system. And I don't want to walk you through all of the different settings, because then we probably could sit here for hours, because you can do so much with that. But there are still some general settings that are required in every network setup you should definitely be familiar with when you're using this firewall system. So let me walk you through some of their menus here. For example, first go to administration, where you can look up all the licensing information, and go to device access. And in the device access menu, you can configure all the protocols or services on the firewall itself that should be accessible from which network. So we can see that it follows the zone concept pretty consequently. So we have different network zone where the traffic can come from, and depending on the zone, you can enable or disable those firewall services. Like for example, the web interface port, SSH sessions, ping, DNS, and SSL VPN. So you can see from the public internet or the wide area network, only SSL VPN is enabled by default. This is the reason why you couldn't access the web interface port from the router's IP network, for example. But it is important when you are setting up SSL connections that you could access the port on the firewall, so therefore it is enabled. But you should not enable some of the other services on that port. But if you still want to do that, you could configure it. And it's important to understand that zone concept you can configure in the network section. And in this menu, you see all the physical, the virtual interfaces that are connected or configured on this firewall. So in the virtual machine, we have attached two network cards to this system, and you see those two network cards here in that interfaces menu. You can see the port A for the local area network and the port B for the wide area network. You could also go in there, change change anything, or you could also add other interfaces. For example, you can add VLANs, you can add link aggregations, alias IP addresses or bridges in here. And if we go to the port B, the wide area network port, you could also configure this a little bit more and set up a static IP address. Or if you want to replace your router, you can also let the SoftwareXG make the PPPoE connection to your DSL provider in case you want to replace your router and set it to modem mode. So this is also possible. Some people do that, but I believe that in most scenarios it will be easier to just go with the default settings, which is DHCP, because then you automatically get an IP address from your router's network and this will be used as your uplink on the SoftwareXG. You can also do other things here, like adding zones to the default ones, or you could go to the DNS settings, set up DNS entries, or change any configuration on the DHCP server of this firewall. And I don't want to walk you through all of these different menus because the default settings are pretty fine for all the home network setups. But if you want to customize this, you will find many how-to guides, videos, and also the online help. So just check it out if you want to customize some of these settings. The firewall offers a lot of this configuration stuff. But the thing that I want to show you in this tutorial is how to protect your local network devices with this firewall. And all this stuff you can set up in the rules and policies. So let's go to that menu. This is a core of the operating system, the firewall rules, where you can configure which traffic is allowed to come in and go out of this network. And by default, there are some templates and rules configured here, but I want to start completely from scratch and show you this step by step. So let's select all of this and let's delete the default rules and groups. So any firewall works the same way. Usually you define your rules where you can match the traffic, you can accept or deny it. And all these rules work from top to bottom. So for every traffic that comes into the firewall, it will check against the rule sets if it matches the rules, and it will ask, is the first rule matching? No. Then I go to the second rule. Is that matching? Yes, I will do the action that is configured in this rule. If it's not matching, it will just go to the next and so on. And at the end of all this rule set, it usually drops all the network traffic that hasn't matched any of these rules. So for any traffic that you have not configured, the firewall will just drop it. So you always need to tell the firewall which traffic is allowed to come in or also go out. So this is something you usually don't configure in a router, because there you probably just set up which traffic will be forwarded to which internal service, but you usually don't configure what traffic is allowed to go outside. But this is something you can do very specifically with that firewall, which is very powerful. Because, for example, let's just try to access the internet. You can see that this is not possible because the firewall will automatically drop the traffic. We haven't told it to allow this. So let's create a new firewall rule. And let's name this Internet Access, for example. Now, I want to position that rule at the top because it should always match. And I don't want to put this into a group. And the action should be accept. So you could also reject all traffic, or you could accept or drop it, depending on your needs. And I also want to lock it, because then the firewall will keep track of syslogging and it will also display the traffic when it's matching in the log viewer. And now we need to fill in the source zone. So remember, we had two zones here that are important, the local area network and the wide area network. And we want to define a rule that accepts the traffic that comes from the local network and goes to the public network. So let's add the zone local area network. And in the destination zone, we will select the wide area network. So now you could also define in much more detail to which IP addresses, networks, host names, or whatever this rule should apply. But in most scenarios, you probably should just define your zone. But in case you have a server where you want to enable different protocols, or you want to have different policies to be enabled on this device, you can simply just add an IP address for this device and statically configure this in your DHCP server, for example. So now we need to select which services should be enabled, and you could just select any services. So then all protocols are allowed to match this firewall rule. But in my case, I just want to allow HTTP and HTTPS traffic, because this is used for internet access most of the time. So let's apply those two services here. And for now, let's click on save. So now there's a second thing that is important to allow internet access, and this is network address translation. So this is important, and probably every router or consumer device just does network address translation by default, but it's important for IT guys to understand what network address translation is. And this is when you send traffic from any local network device, it has a local IP address like 172.16.16, and then an IP address that it got from the DHCP server, but once we connect to the public internet, we can't use this local IP address, because we need to masquerade this IP address when the traffic goes outside of our local network so that the device or the server we are reaching can send this traffic back to our public IP address. With a local IP address, this wouldn't work. So we need to set up a masquerading rule that masquerades all internal IP addresses once the traffic goes outside of our network. This is usually configured by default in Sophos XG when you go to the NAT rules and select the default SNAT IPv4. So this is an IPv4 rule that masquerades the inbound traffic coming from all inbound interfaces which go out to the outbound. And whatever consumer device just does by default, you can configure in so much more detail in this menu here. But just to mention, the default rule should be fine in case you have multiple uplinks or you want to customize any DNAT rules, you want to do port forwardings. This is what you can set up in the NAT rules and policies. So let's go back to our internet access. You can also see that there is some traffic already going through that rule. You can identify it when traffic comes in or goes out of this rule. Let's go to our browser and let's just refresh the page, and you can see internet access is now working. So this is fine for usual web access. So when you open the browser or you browse any websites, this is now allowed in the firewall's rule set. But for example, what if you want to do a ping to a server? Let's try to do that and open a command prompt and type in ping the DNS server of Google, for example. You can see this is not working because we haven't told the firewall to allow this traffic here. It's just matching HTTP and HTTPS traffic. So we now could just add another rule to enable this, or we simply can edit our current one. But let's just add another firewall rule that is called ping access, for example. And you can now position this on top of the HTTP or HTTPS rule, but we will go with the bottom section and don't want to attach this to a group. Of course, we need to select the source zone, which is local area network. The destination zone is wide area network, but the services are ICMP in this example here. So let's select ICMP version 6 and version 4, and let's click on save. So now if we try to ping the server again, you can see this is now working. And it works this way. First of all, the firewall will check, is this traffic matching to the first rule? No, it will check against the second rule, it will match to this rule, and if we now reload the page, you should also see that there's some traffic coming in and going out of this firewall rule. So this is how you can configure the basic rule set. You should always try to follow the approach and try to deny everything, and then find out what's not working and try to add a firewall rule for the traffic you want to allow from your local network to go outside. Obviously, you also need to do the same for the inbound traffic, so traffic that comes into your server, but just to explain how this stuff works is because you could argue when you send some traffic to Google, of course there's some traffic coming back. Shouldn't we allow this traffic? This is not needed because the traffic always matches the sessions. This is why the firewalls are usually called stateful firewalls. So they will keep track of the TCP session that is established once you send a request to the web server. It comes back and it will automatically recognize, oh, this traffic belongs to an established session that we've initiated from inside. This is something that the firewall automatically remembers. Every time you initiate a session, the traffic comes back and it will always match this to an established session. This traffic is always allowed. Okay, so this is great. Internet access is now allowed. We can now browse any websites, but this is probably just a basic functionality you can do with so many systems. The Sophos XG can do so much more because you can also scan the websites you're browsing and very specifically say which websites are allowed to browse. And this is working with a web filtering or URL scanning of the firewall. And you can also enable all of this stuff in the firewall rules. So you can also add firewall rules based on specific IP addresses or based on specific zones and attach security policies to them. So let's select the internet access rule and let's scroll down to security policies, web filtering, and let's click on the drop down menu, and then we can attach a web policy. So when we click on that menu, you can see there are some default or pre-configured rules by Sophos, the allow all rule, the deny all rule, no online chat, no webmail, some templates here you can also customize. So let me show you how these rules work. So let's go to the web menu here, where you'll find all these different web filter policies. And you can see the default policy. This is a typical starter policy with options suitable for many organizations. probably also for home networks. So when you click on the drop-down menu, you can see different rule sets here with different URL categories. So what Sophos does is Sophos maintains their own web categorization engine that's built into their firewall product you can completely use for free. And they categorize most websites on the internet in specific categories where you can really clearly define, oh, this website belongs to risky downloads, or this website belongs to search engines. And in the web filter policy, you can define which categories are allowed from the network and which you want to block or which you probably want to warn. So in the default policy, you can see that not all of this stuff is enabled here, but you can also see what's inside those categories. For example, let's go to the second one here, the user group for risky download and suspicious. So when you edit this, you can also see that this is a collection of multiple categories or also file types. So for example, risky downloads are download freeware, shareware, intellectual piracy, or executable files, system files, something like an .exe file. You would find a download link on a web page. This probably would be suspicious, so you want to block this file type here. But you can also find other stuff here. For example, this group, you can find explicit content and some other stuff here. I don't want to go into too much detail here, but this is usually useful for a home network where you want to block all this stuff. You can also block custom stuff. For example, let's try to block any search engines, which probably is nothing you want to do, but in case you just want to test out the web filtering, this is a good example. So let's add another policy that is called no search engines, and let's add another rule where we add a new item and just search for search. So you can see that it usually searches for user activity, which are collections of those categories, but you can also specify URL groups or web categories here, for example, just this category search engine, or you can select the user activity search, which has a collection of image search and search engines included. So it's up to you what you do with this filtering. So for example, I just want to add a search engine here, so I will select this one. And of course, I also need to enable this, otherwise this wouldn't work. And let's just save. You can do so much with that, but I don't want to go into too much detail here. So now we have just created the policy. We haven't attached this to a firewall rule. So the traffic still uses no policy. So let's go back to the firewall rules, select internet access, which will match to all HTTP and HTTPS traffic. And then we will scroll to web filtering and enable the policy no search engines. So let's click on save and you can see what happens now. Okay, so let's just try to open some websites here. For example, let's try to open the Digital Life, which is basically a very, very cool website where you can learn about IT technologies and become an IT professional. So just check it out. It's pretty nice. Or let's just try to access YouTube, for example. So this will also work. But if we try to access a search engine, for example, google.com, you can see that this website is blocked because it's categorized as search engines. And this works in all scenarios. You simply can just attach those different policies to different firewall rules and protect some IP addresses, some networks, or maybe your entire network with a general policy where you just allow specific categories and other categories like risky downloads, suspicious downloads, or explicit content. For example, let's also enable this one here. Apply the changes here, and then we can go back to the firewall rule, select the internet access rule, change the web policy to the default one, for example. And then we have a pretty great setup. So if we now try to open Google again, you can see this is not blocked anymore. Okay, so this is great. This is how you can protect your entire network and you can block suspicious or certain URL categories for all your network devices. But what if someone tries to download a virus? What if you connect to an encrypted website where there is some bad content on the website itself? The firewall can also look inside the HTTPS traffic and detect this stuff as well. And let's go to the internet access and I can show you how that works, because in the security features of web filtering, you can't just apply a web policy that uses URL categorization. You can also scan HTTP and decrypt HTTPS traffic. So these features require some preparation. And let me just explain it this way. When you enable the decryption of HTTPS, the firewall firewall needs to look inside an encrypted connection. So when you open a website like the Digital Life, it is usually encrypted with HTTPS and it's using a certificate. So then the browser will validate the certificate of the website if it's generally trusted. And you can also inspect the certification path where this certificate comes from. But if the firewall needs to look inside this encrypted web traffic, it needs to break the encryption and encrypt it again with its own certificate. This is also sometimes called a man in the middle attack, but in a good way, because we want to use that to look inside the content of the websites and want to scan this for malware or for any bad activities. But when you just enable this feature and you configure it, all devices within your network will always see a certification warning whenever they access any website. And this is something you need to do on all devices, because you need to tell the devices to trust the firewall to break the encryption and encrypt it again with its own certificate. And the way how you can do this is, and you can do this by the way on all laptops, all PCs, also smartphones and tablets, is you need to download the firewall's certification authority and import it in the trusted root certification authority store of your client. Let me quickly show you how to do that. So let's go to certificates and let's go to certificate authorities, and then you will find a security appliance SSL CA, which is a certification authority that the Surface XG uses for their web filtering engine. So let's click on download and store this somewhere. And now we need to import this on our device. So in the support section of Surface, you will find many articles describing certain functions of the firewalls or sometimes explaining something, right? So for example, there's a great article I will share with you and put in the description down below on the SSL CA certificate installation guide. And this describes how you can do that on different devices and different browsers. So I will just show you that on Windows with a Brave or a Chromium browser, for example. Just go to the menu, go to settings, and then you go to privacy and security, scroll down to security. And the last menu is called Manage Certificates. So when you open this, the usual Windows program to manage and import any certificate should open on your PC. And then you simply need to select Trusted Root Certification Authorities. And in that menu, simply click on Import and select the file that we've just downloaded. You also need to change the file type to make it visible here. Click on Next and place all certificates in the following store, the Trusted Root Certification Authorities. Click on Next and click on Finish and accept this. Okay, so this was now successful. We now haven't enabled the HTTPS decryption yet. So let me show you how to do that in the firewall. Let's go back to Rules and Policies, Internet Access, and let's scroll down to Security Features. So now we need to enable Scan HTTP and Decrypt HTTPS. And you can also enable zero-day protection. So this is a feature that Surface offers, is whenever it tries to scan a file which hasn't been scanned before and it doesn't really know if this is malicious or not, it can send this file to Surface cloud services where they do some sandboxing, deep analysis with machine learning, and they're able to detect even zero-day exploits that haven't been around or shared in any anti-malware patterns. So this is pretty sophisticated. It probably takes a few minutes until the file is analyzed, but for any suspicious files where there could be a virus that hasn't been detected by any antivirus engine yet, you could use this to even detect unknown malware. And this is very, very powerful. You can also use this. So the right menu is for enabling the web proxy instead of the DPI engine. Let me quickly explain what that means. So on the Surface website, you can read more about the DPI engine, which is powered by the Extreme Protection, which is included in the newer versions of the firewalls. And it has a TLS 1.3 decryption. It has a deep packet inspection, which means it can look inside any connections and decrypt content and scan it. It doesn't really matter on which port these connections are. So what you usually will see on other firewalls, they sometimes have a web proxy, a transparent proxy that redirects any HTTPS web traffic on port 443 to their internal proxy and then scans the web traffic. So the DPI engine of Surface can even scan the traffic on all the different ports, and it doesn't really need to redirect the traffic to a transparent proxy. It's much more performant, but it doesn't do all the features that web proxy does. So therefore you can always enable this for backwards compatibility, but I would just go with the DPI engine because it's much faster and it's just better. So now when we click on save, we have just enabled the HTTPS decryption, but we haven't really told the firewall what it should do with this traffic. So when you try to open a new connection, you can still see that this is a valid certificate from the homepage itself. The firewall is not inspecting the traffic yet. So this is because in the new version of Surface XG, you can configure this in a separate menu, which is called SSL and TLS inspection rules. And there you can configure in much more detail how it should decrypt HTTPS connection and how it's handled this. So this is powered by the DPI engine, and once this is enabled, you can add another rule here, for example, decrypt SSL, and then you can define the action decrypt. You can also don't decrypt for specific categories, for specific websites, and you can also add a specific decryption profile where you can configure how restrictive the decryption process should be. So for example, if you want to block any insecure SSL, for example, old websites use outdated versions of SSL, so probably you want to block them automatically, or you don't want to decrypt all websites because there are some problems with that. You can also add exception rules for all of this stuff, but no, we want to just use the block insecure SSL decryption profile and want to define a profile that is valid for the source zone local area network for all IP addresses. The destination zone will be wide area network, all IP addresses and all services and all categories and websites. So you can really fine-tune all these settings here in that menu. But once we added a new decryption policy, let's go back to a website like the Digital Life and let's try to access it. Sometimes you need to reload the browser to make this working, and you can see that when you know inspect the certificate, it is issued by the Sophos SSL CA. So that tells you that the firewall is hooking into the HTTPS connection, it has broken it, and encrypted it with its own certificate again. So this is something you can also inspect in the log view of the firewall. I haven't shown you this yet. So let's go back to the firewall's menu. Let's open the log viewer. So here you can look into all of the processes that are running on the firewall itself. You can do policy testing. You can see which traffic has been allowed, which has been blocked and so on. And this is a basic firewall menu where you can see which traffic has matched to which firewall rule. You can even reload that or see that in real time. But when you select this menu here and go to web filtering, you can see all the websites that have been browsed and analyzed through the web filtering. So you can even see it when you just enable URL scanning, but here you can see in so much detail which IP address has browsed which category, which websites, at which time. You can of course also filter for all this stuff, and this is really, really nice. So now the firewall is looking into all of our web traffic and it's scanning all the downloads we are making, it's scanning the content of the websites, the URLs, and it also adds zero-day protection for any unknown malware that you probably might download somewhere. So this is really, really nice. But let me also show you how you can test this, because when you go to a website that is called icar.com, where you can download an anti-malware test file. So this is not a real virus, but it should be detected by your computer as a real virus. Otherwise, you're not protected. So let's try to download this one, for example. And you can see this is not working because this website contains malware. So that has been scanned by Sophos. So the firewall is also able to extract any zip archives and detect any malicious content packed into that file. So that is also pretty powerful. When we now go to the log viewer, you can also see what happened here. Because when we open it and go to the malware filtering, you can see that it detected a malware. This was the icar test virus sample here, and it was detected and blocked in the download. So this is very, very cool. You can do a lot of stuff with that, but we are not done yet because you can add more security. Let's go to internet access here and scroll down to other security features, because we also have two other main features of the firewall, which is identify and control applications, the app control, and prevent any exploits, the IPS protection. So the IPS protection is something I don't want to go into too much detail yet, because I will do a second or a separate video on intrusion prevention systems with Snort on Linux servers, so that might be also very interesting. But you can also enable a detect and prevent exploits. So this is important when someone sends you a malicious payload in any network request. So maybe a program does a malicious exploit or run something. You want to detect and prevent this. So you can select different policies here. You can also customize them, but usually the LAN-to-WAN general policy is great for a network rule that goes from the local area network to the public network. So we can enable this. And of course, the Sophos actually scans the network traffic for known malicious patterns of exploits that are around somewhere and tries to block them. But the really cool thing is the application control. So with the application control, you can allow or deny specific applications that uses network connections but are not specifically using HTTP or HTTPS protocols, which would be covered by the web filtering. So for example, if you have have an application that uses a different protocol, for example RDP or VNC, or any messengers that usually sometimes use different protocols, Sophos maintains a category of different applications that are put into specific categories and risk levels. And you can also attach different policies to those firewall rules, for example an allow rule, a deny rule, or specifically block very risky applications or high risk applications. So if you want to know what is actually defined in those rules, we can take a look at the applications menu where you'll find all these different policies. For example, let's take a look at the block high risk applications, and then you will see all the applications that are based on a risk level. So in the risk level 4, there are things like messengers, chats, and other protocols. For example, WhatsApp is also in here. So you could also block any WhatsApp communication by just blocking any high risk applications. And in the very high risk applications, there are harmful protocols in here. So some VPN protocols, peer-to-peer sharing, and those kind of things. But there are also other application filters, for example the block generally unwanted apps. So if you go in here, you can see that there are filters based on specific categories, for example peer-to-peer file sharing or some other bad applications that are somehow categorized. And you can also add custom block lists or can add custom exclusions to these lists. For example, let's start with the block high-risk applications, and for example you don't like that WhatsApp is in here blocked, so you may want to add an exclusion for WhatsApp messaging. You can simply can click on add here and then use some of their categories, filters, statistics. You can for example use a smart filter like WhatsApp for example, and then all applications that are matching this specific keyword are listed in here, and you can define some actions for that. For example, just allow WhatsApp and put this on top of all the other rules so that we add an exclusion for any WhatsApp messaging. But you can also block certain things. For example, let's try to add a block for Office 365. You can search for that in here, or you can just select an individual application like Office, and you can find the application Office 365, and also the Office Click to Run application is categorized in here, and some other stuff that doesn't have to do anything with Microsoft Office. But let's, for example, let's just try to block this one, select the action deny and click on save. And now we want to save this policy. And let's go to the firewalls and select our internet access rule, and then just select our policy, the block high risk applications. Let's click on save. And we should be now able to access WhatsApp, but high risk applications are now blocked. For example, if you try to open Office, you should see that the application itself opens, but we are run into an error because it couldn't communicate to the server anymore. This traffic is now categorized and blocked by the firewall. And this works without any URL scanning or decryption, and that is pretty nice. So when we go to the log viewer, you can also see when we go to the application filter here that Sophos XG denied web traffic for this specific application. So this is all great. So these are some of the great security features that offers an enterprise-grade firewall you can easily put in your home network. And I also want to show you the reporting here, because the reporting is also pretty nice. You can get a lot of insight in what is happening into your home network. So for example, when we scroll down from the traffic dashboard, you can see all the applications that are used, the risk level, the category, and you can also see any details for specific filtering and security features. For example, this is just the traffic dashboard. We also have a security dashboard and also applications and web. So when you go in here, you can get much more insight in the different websites that you have browsed, which IP addresses have opened, which connections to website, the average number of applications and risk levels that are used. And you also have an average risk meter within your network, so that identifies the average risk level of applications that you are using in your network. And you may want to fine tune this. You can also go to network and threats and identify blocks that have been categorized as malicious here, or look inside other features of this firewall as well. You could even generate custom reports, like a custom web report where you can see all the different URLs of the websites or whatever you want to do. This is very, very nice, and you don't want to go into too much detail, but the reporting is also pretty great. You can also see the current activities in this menu here when you go to live connections, and then you see all the different network connections that are established through the firewall system. You can see the upstream and downstream bandwidth, based on applications, for example, so that is using Skype for some reason, maybe in the background, Windows update stuff, or based on source IP addresses, you can look into specific metrics. So this is a great example how you can use a Sophos XG firewall to protect your home network and add any firewall rules to specifically define which traffic is allowed to come in and go out, or use some of their advanced security features like web filtering or application protection that are baked into this product and just use this as a home user completely for free. Okay, so to be fair, this was just a brief overview of this firewall because Sophos XG is an enterprise-grade firewall with a rich feature set you can use in so many different scenarios. And maybe there's something specific you want to do with this system, or you may have questions or suggestions for future videos about Sophos XG, then please tell me that in the comments. I would love to create more home server project videos and tutorials for you. And as always, I've put you a suggestion for another great video about network security in the video description you should watch next. So thanks everybody for watching, and I see you in the next one. Bye bye.